I want to redo this problem with a twist. So the problem I did, and I'll link to the video down below, I just did it. There's a ball of clay, two balls of clay, and this one swings down and collides and sticks with that one. And then the question is, how high up does it go? And so, you know, I broke into three parts: work energy as it swings down, inelastic collision as they collide, and then it swings up. And I did that, I did that, I did that. And then I got that for my final answer. The height is 1/9. So the mass of the balls, it was 1 to 2. So this is 1/9 the height. That's what I got. I'm never sure that I'm right. I may have made a mistake. That's possible. That's always possible, right? It's always possible to make a mistake. But I want to model it with Python because I think that's fun. So let's just draw one single pendulum and think about how we would model that. And there's a lot of ways to do it, but I want to do it without any complicated differential equations, really, but kind of also. Here's what I'm going to do. So I have my mass. I just want to get one ball swinging like that. And of course, there's a tension that way and a gravitational force this way. And that's what makes this problem so difficult, is that this ball is confined to swing in a circle such that the length of the string is constant. And so how does this force know to be whatever it needs to be to make that in a circle? And it doesn't. The answer is it doesn't know, really. But it's not a constant force, right? As it swings down, the angle changes, the speed changes, the acceleration changes. Not easy. Not easy at all. So we can cheat. So the way we cheat is to replace the string with a spring. And so a spring, I can calculate the force on this ball due to a spring, because it depends on how much it stretches. And what will happen is that the ball is not going to move in a circular path now, because it's going to oscillate down. But if I make this really stiff, then it mostly stays in a circular path, and it will mostly work. And so that's what we're going to do. So how do we calculate the force from a spring like that? Well, at a couple points here. So first I need this vector, I'll call it this ball A. I'll call this from the pivot point down here, I'm going to call this RA, the vector RA. And then I need this length L, the scalar length of the string before it's stretched. And the spring force will just be proportional to the amount that this is either stretched or compressed. So I can write this. FA, the force on A due to that spring, is going to be negative some spring constant times the magnitude. I'm writing it out in Python. I'm sorry. FA is negative K times the magnitude of that vector RA minus L, right? Because I want just the distance. I don't care about the direction. And that's a scalar value, so that I have to do that. But then I don't have a vector over here, so I'm going to have to multiply this by RA hat, a unit vector in the direction. So the unit vector is this way. Imagine if RA is longer than L, then this is going to be in the negative direction, so it's going to pull back that way. If RA is less than that, it's going to push it this way. So that should make it swing back and forth. Let's just go ahead and model just this, and then I'll come back and we'll look at collisions. I'm going to make one pendulum, and then I'll make a second pendulum. The second one's going to be down here, just hanging like this, and that'll be ball B. And this is, remember, we need to pick some values here. So let's say MA is 0.1. I don't really care. That's MA. MB is twice that. I need to pick a length. L is, let's say, 0.1. I'm just picking one. I need to pick a spring constant, and we want that to be high. Let's just start with 1,000 newtons per meter, and let's see what happens. Oh, I need an initial angle just so I can write that. Theta is, I don't know, 30 degrees. Now, one other thing I'm going to go ahead and say, I want this to be my origin because I want to measure that height, and that way I can just use the y value. So it's going to make it look bad, but I don't really care. Okay, so I'm going to make a pivot point, I'm going to make this mass, I'm going to make the string, and I'm going to model the whole thing. Let's get to Python. And then we'll come back and do the collision. Python. Okay, so I'm using WebVPython. It's what I always use. It has a lot of the features built in that I like for animating stuff. So I'm just going to start off with the grav. Is that big enough? No. That's big enough. G is vector 0, negative 0, negative 9.80. I need the mass. I'm putting all my constants in here. Let's just say M is 0.1, and then I'll set the masses of the individual objects. L is 0.1. Theta, what did I say? It's 30. 30 times pi over 180. K. I'm going to have two spring constants, so I'm going to call this K1. K1 is 1,000. Do I have everything that I need? Okay, let's just go. So I'm gonna make a pivot point where I attach things to. And so if the bottom is gonna be at zero, this is gonna be at L in the y direction. So let's make the pivot. So pivot is equal to a sphere. Its position is gonna be equal to the vector 0, L, 0. And its radius, let's put it at L over 30. That's fine. Let's just run this. I always like to run it after just making one sphere to make... Okay, there's my pivot point up there. Okay, that looks good. I guess I can... And then I can save it. For some reason, if you, like, try to save it... let's see. Colliding clay pendulum. Oh, I misspelled that. Doesn't matter. It kind of probably does matter, because if I go looking for that, I'm not going to find it. Oh, well. So there's my pivot. Now I'm going to make my first mass. I'm going to call that A. So let's call it ball A. It's a sphere. It's now its position is going to be from the pivot. I'm going to go down negative L cosine theta over negative L sine theta. So its position is going to be pivot.pos plus L times vector negative sine of theta negative cosine theta, 0. And then I need a radius. Let's make it a little bit bigger. L over 20. And let's make it yellow. Run. Okay, there. That looks pretty good. So there's my pivot point. There's my ball A. Now let's make the string. So string A, because we're going to have another one. I'm going to use a cylinder. So a cylinder has two main properties. Number one, the position. That's the location of one end. The axis is a vector from that end to the other end. And then it has radius. So this is a cylinder position. I'm going to stick it at the pivot, pivot.pos. Axis is going to be ball A.pos minus pivot.pos. That's that vector from the pivot to the ball. And then the radius is going to be L over 100. Let's try that. Yeah, that looks nice. Okay, so we're doing great here. Okay, now I'm going to go ahead and calculate the forces and all that stuff. So I need a couple things. I need the mass of ball A. I need the momentum of ball A. So ball A dot M is going to be equal to M. Ball A dot P is going to be 0. I'm starting from rest. So what I'm going to do is, once I calculate that force due to the spring, I'm going to use that force to update the momentum, use that momentum to update the position, and then keep doing that over and over again. Standard numerical calculation thing. Should I show that? I'm going to show that. I mean, I know we're here, right? And maybe we've done this a bunch of times, but it doesn't hurt to show. I'm going to switch back over to the paper real quick. So if I have a non-constant force on an object in some short time interval, let's say delta t is 0.001 seconds, then I can write F net is the change in momentum with respect to time. And I can assume during this time interval that force is constant. So this is going to be equal to P2 minus P1 over delta t. I can solve this for P2. It's P1. Plus F net, which I just called N, delta T. So this is the momentum at the beginning of the time interval. That's why I need that initial momentum. Calculate the force, and I can find the momentum at the end of the time interval. Now I can do the same thing for the average velocity. I can say V V average, which I'll again assume is constant, is going to, yeah, it's going to be the change in position with respect to time. So if I write that as R2 minus R1 over delta T, and I use P2 for the average velocity, which it's not, but it's close enough, I get R2 equals R1 plus P2 over M delta T. So here's what I'm going to do. Calculate the force with whatever equation I want. Use that to update the momentum. Use that to update the position. And then do it all again. That's how it works. And that's a simple model, but it works. It's going to work. Okay, I need time, T. I need scrolling. T equals 0. dt equals 0.001. Yep. Okay. So now let's just run it for 2 seconds. While t is less than 2, rate 1,000. So rate 1,000 says don't do more than 1,000 loops per second. And since I have a time step of 1/1,000th, this would be real time. Step number one, calculate the force. Fa is going to be equal to negative K1 times, oh, I need to do this. Let's calculate RA. It's going to be ball A dot P, yeah, dot PUS minus pivot dot PUS. All right, it's that vector from the pivot point to the ball. Now I'm going to take the magnitude of that, magnitude of RA, minus L, which is just a with the scalar, times norm RA. So norm returns the unit vector, mag returns the magnitude. And this will calculate the force on the ball. I can use that to update the momentum. Ball A dot P equals ball A dot P plus FA times DT. Aha! I didn't include gravity. So I'm going to say plus ball A dot M times G. It's plus, right? Because G has a negative Y component, but this is the net force. I'm adding up the forces. So don't put minus MG. That's the Y component, the Y components are in G. Now I'm going to update the position. Ball A dot PUS dot equals ball A dot PUS plus ball A dot P times ET divided by ball A dot M. I do need to also move the string, right? Or I'm just going to get my ball moving back and forth. So I don't need to change the position. It's still going to be at the pivot. But I do need to change the axis. So I'm actually going to recalculate RA. No, I can just do it this way. String A dot POS equals ball A dot POS minus pivot dot POS. And now I'm going to update time. T equals T plus DT. This should work. I'm always afraid it won't work, but you gotta run it to find out, right? Okay, so my it works, but my string's way down there. What did I, string is pivot.pos. That's true. Okay. Oh, string.axis. There we go. It is, you can see it bouncing up and down a little bit. So let's just increase this to say 5,000. Might even need to make it higher. Let's do this just to see. Make trail equals true, and then we'll really be able to see. Make trail equals true. Okay, that looks pretty good. I mean, it's wiggling some. You can see it's wiggling some, but I could also make the mass less. Let's just make the mass 0.5. Okay, that's pretty good. Let's go ahead and add the other mass without the collision. So I just need to do the same thing. So down here, I have ball B equals sphere position. I can just copy all this stuff. Well, position equals pivot.pos plus vector 0, negative L, 0. So this is straight down from the pivot. And then I'll give it a radius of the same thing, L over 30. And I need to give it a color. Color equals color dot cyan. You have to have a color, it's the rule. String B is cylinder. I should just copy that, but I didn't. Position equals pivot dot POS, not ops, POS. Axis equals ball B dot POS minus pivot dot POS. And then radius equals L over 100. The mass, ball B dot M is going to be 2 times M. And then the momentum, ball B dot P, vector 0, 0, 0. Now down here, I need to calculate. I'm just doing the same stuff I did for the other ball. So I need to find its position, RB, ball B dot POS minus pivot dot POS. I need to calculate its force. This one I am going to copy. And I'm going to dedent that, change that to B, same spring constant, B. Now I will copy these two, both of these. I can do these out of order, it doesn't really matter. And dedent, change that to B. Now it shouldn't really be doing much, it will do something, but ball B should just be kind of hanging there, but it won't, and that's fine. And B, and then I do need to update the axis for string B. Okay, let's see. Run it. I didn't save it either. Save it. Now run it. Okay. So there's no collision because I didn't tell it to collide. And why is that one so much bigger? Let's see. So I did ball B is L over 30. Oh, that's L over 20. Let's just switch these up. Make that 30 and make this one 20. Because ball B is supposed to be more massive. 20. That looks better. Okay. So now we are ready for a collision. Now, this is an inelastic collision, which is a little bit more complicated to model than an elastic collision. For an elastic collision, I could just have the two masses with the spring force between them. Let me switch over to the paper and we can draw this out. So imagine that I have two balls. I'm getting a piece of paper. And I want them to collide. Did this freeze up? Okay, so I want them to collide. So if they collide, I have this ball overlapping that ball. Now they're in contact. So I'm going to say contact equals true. Right? I want to know if they're in contact. And then I'm going to calculate the distance from one to the other, the vector distance right there. I'll call that RA to B. So this is A and that's B. And then if they overlapped or if they're in contact, either one, once they make contact, I'm gonna make them stay in contact. So once they overlap, I can just do this, have a spring right here. So FAB is gonna be equal to negative K2 times the magnitude of RAB minus RA plus RB, right? That's the sum of the radiuses, the distance between those, times RAB hat. Now, that would push them apart if they overlap. But then how do I pull them back together? I want to make them just be stuck together with a spring, which isn't exactly an inelastic collision, but it's kind of the way I like it. We can add in a dampening force if you want, but I don't know if I want to. I guess I should, but whatever. So if once they make contact, I need to have this variable contact equals true so that I can then say if they overlap or if contact is true, then that's the force. Otherwise, if you just say if they overlap, then they'll push each other apart. They won't really stick together. So that's what we're going to do. So let's do that. It's not too bad to add in there. Okay. I mean, it's conceptually tricky to think about how you would add that in there. So I'm going to go up here, and I'm going to make this two things, spring constant 2, and I'll make it a little bit weaker, K2 equals 1,000. And we can change it up if you want to. It doesn't really matter. I can also, let's do this. Let's call it RAB. That's the distance between them. It's going to be ball A dot radius plus ball B dot radius. I'll need that in my calculation. I don't have to do that. And then I'm going to say contact equals false. So that means they're not in contact to start off with. Do I need... Yes, and I do need a force. I'll call this FAB. It's the force on B due to A. It's the vector 0, 0, 0. Because I'm going to include it in my calculations even before they collide. And so if it's not there, then it's not going to work. So here, when I calculate the force on A, this is actually negative FAB. I don't know why I did it that way. And plus FAB. So there's internal force, right? It pushes on B. That's why I have to add that force in there. But that means that B pushes back on A with the opposite amount. So that's that. Now I need to calculate. What should I do first? I should do this first. Let's do RAB is going to be ball B dot POS minus ball A dot POS. And now I can say, if the magnitude of RAB is less than RAB, the distance between them, or contact, right? If the contact's true, then they're colliding too. Now I can calculate that force. FAB is negative K2 times mag RAB minus RAB, capital, right? Minus ball, yeah, okay. Minus RAB times norm RAB, and that's the force. And once they are in contact, and the first time they overlap, I'm gonna change contact to true. Okay, let's see if that works. I always get these things backwards. A lot of times they explode and I always feel bad, but you know, you don't know until you make it. Look at that. That's pretty good. Okay, so now we need to make a plot. I want to see how high it goes and see if the final height is 1/9. And so we could do this a couple ways. I'm just going to make a graph. Let's just make a graph of the... I'm going to calculate the center mass for the two balls and plot that because they're shaking. Okay. We can fix that later. So let's make a graph. Up here, I will say G1 equals graph. Let's give it a title. Let's be official. Title equals colliding clay pendulum. I'm going to put this on separate lines. X title, I'm going to plot the height as a function of time. X title is going to be just time in seconds. Y title is going to be equal to Y in meters. Oops, put that one like that. And then width equals 500, height equals 250. That's just the size of the graph that works for me. F1 equals G curve, color equals color dot blue. And then I'm going to plot two things. F2 equals G curve, color equals color dot red. So the two graph, I'm going to plot the Y position of ball A, right, which should give me the whole answer. But then in order to take care of the shaking, I'm also going to plot the center mass of the two. So let's calculate the center mass of the two down here. I'm going to call it comp for center of mass. Get it? It's going to be equal to ball A dot POS, POS times ball A dot M plus ball B dot POS times ball B dot M divided by ball A dot M plus ball b dot m. That's it. Now I'm going to need to redo that down here in the loop. So let's do that down here. And now I can plot f1 dot plot t ball a dot pos dot y and f2 t ball b, no, com dot y. Com is not a thing. I don't need position. It's just a vector. So I'm going to plot those two things, and now let's just see if this even works. Okay, so the red one is the center of mass. The initial position I have is right here. So I'm going to write this down. So I'm writing it down over here. I could print that out too. I'm going to be approximately 0.0134. That's H1. Okay, now for H2, and you'll notice down here that the zero is the lowest point. So H2 is the height of this. Now, it wiggles some still, and we'll see if we can correct that. But you see, this is at about 0.0. H2 is 0.0013. And what is the difference between those two? So is that 1/9 as much? Let me just get my calculator. I'm actually doing Python. But I wrote down the numbers. And there's a better way. I know there's a better way to do that. But I just want to do it with my calculator. Clear. So I'm going to take this. This divided by that. Well, yeah. So let's take this and divide by 9. So 0.0134 divided by 9. 0.0014. So that's pretty close. I mean, it's close enough that I'm going to say it counts. Now, I do want to add in drag. I want to add in a drag force. Just to see if I can make it look a little bit better. I'm trying to think. No, I think I'm not going to add in a drag force, because I would need to add a drag force for the relative motion, which I could do. Let's just do it real quick. Let's see if we can do it. So I'm going to just, I want it to be great, right? And if it's a 38-minute video, it's a 38-minute video. If you want to watch, you don't have to watch, right? So down here, B equals my drag coefficient, B. And what I'm going to do is multiply this by the relative momentums. I think I can do it. So I'm going to say down here, F drag on B. And I'm going to get this backwards, and I don't really mind. Minus B times the relative momentum, which would be ball B dot P minus ball A dot P. And so I know I got it backwards. Well, let's just think. So if they're both moving, if they're relative to each other, if they're moving further apart, then I want, and this is on B? Yeah, this is on B. So now down here, I'm just going to do it. I'm going to say minus FDB, got that wrong, FDB, and this one plus FDB. If it didn't work, I'll just delete it and pretend like it didn't happen. Oh, it did work. Look, it smoothed out. Okay, now we can, nice. I guessed right. So let's just increase that to 10. Nice. Look at that. And yeah, it didn't lose energy either. So, I mean, it did lose energy overall, but not after they stuck together and they swung together. I'm pretty happy with that. Okay, cool. I will put a link to the previous video down below and a link to this code if you want to play around with it. So that was fun. I saved it. I'm pretty happy. And I will talk to you later.